Welcome, everybody, to the Informed Secular Minds podcast. I am Corey, and I am joined today, once again, by Scott. He is El Deuterino on the interwebs. You can follow him on Periscope and on Twitter, and I sincerely encourage you to do that. You may remember him from our episode. A few episodes back, we did a whole episode on simulation hypothesis, and he was my guest host for that episode. It was a fantastic episode. If you haven't heard it, please go back and check that out. You can hear that on blogtalkradio.com, or you can subscribe to our podcast on iTunes. You can just search for Informed Secular Minds, and you can find it there. I'll also put a tweet up at @ismpodcast_ afterwards so that everybody can find us on iTunes and get the content there. This week, we're going to do an episode on Scientology. This is something that has fascinated me for quite some time. I've always kind of been curious about it, interested in it, and I've learned about it here and there through my adult life. But we really wanted to stop and break it down and kind of do a whole podcast episode on it. And in the course of preparing for the episode, we found out just how much there is to know. Every time we learn something new, it would just open another door of strangeness that we would begin to kind of investigate, and then another one inside of that, and another one inside of that. And so we ended up deciding that what we would do is we would do a double episode. We're going to do this one as part one today. And then next Wednesday, we'll do a follow-up episode where we'll cover all of the stuff that we don't have time to get to this episode. Before we really get started, I want to, as always, thank YoungAthlon399. That's his Periscope handle and his Twitter handle, YoungAthlon399. He helps us out with the Periscope side of things, and he is scoping the episode right now live. If you're following ISM_ on Periscope, you can listen to the show there if you're not listening to us on Blog Talk Radio right now. If at any point you want to call in and talk with us, if you got a comment or a question, you want to talk with Scott or myself, you can reach us at 646-564-9551. I thought that I would take a few minutes, though, before we get into the wonderful world of Scientology. On this episode, it's our first show since the inauguration of the 45th President of the United States. And I wanted to talk about America a little bit. January 21st saw what might well be the largest demonstration in human history. Over 4 million people marched on all 7 continents, and I was pleased to have the opportunity to take part in that. People keep telling me that we need to give Trump a chance. To this, I reply, what is wrong with taking him at his word? Do those opposed to the peaceful marches of the past week think he's been lying about everything so far? And if so, why did they vote for him? If not, why should we wait for him to formally do the things he has promised? Wouldn't that be too late to do anything about it? What we are seeing right now is a test of character for the American people. My little piece of American society instilled in my young head that America stood for valor and honor and inclusion. My parents taught me about the melting pot of the United States, the open invitation to the world's tired and poor. I learned that we are a nation of immigrants and that the American dream suggests that by working hard, we can go far, and that all citizens are equal with the same chance at achieving that dream. As I grew up, I learned that America had a long history of discrimination and segregation. Those same immigrants that Lady Liberty welcomed with open arms were labeled and hated at various points in history. But in the decades that followed, those attitudes often thawed as our national character strived again and again for a more perfect union. We never stopped being bigoted and violent towards African Americans, and we never quite got over our hatred of the native peoples of North America. Our character remains blemished by these gross attitudes, but that doesn't destroy the progress we've made in other areas. The inclusive spirit of America helped us embrace the messy beauty of blending cultures and made the American character something greater than the sum of its parts. We have managed to keep our nation more or less secular across the span of the last 240 years. We chased the Nazis across Europe and helped liberate the continent from the grip of fascism. We developed new technologies and innovated new forms of art. We rebuilt after national tragedy and tried in our slightly stupid way to be a shining example to the rest of the world. Then the least popular candidate in history managed to secure the Electoral College and was sworn in as president. He has a lot to say. Here are some examples. On Gonzalo Curiel, Trump told CNN, he's a Mexican, as if that's self-explanatory. We're building a wall between here and Mexico. The answer is, he is giving us very unfair rulings, rulings that people can't even believe. Curiel, it should be noted, is an American citizen who was born in Indiana, and as a prosecutor in the late 1990s, he went after Mexican drug cartels, making him a target for assassination by a Tijuana drug lord. Another quote from Trump. Black guys counting my money. I hate it. The only kind of people I want counting my money are short guys wearing yarmulkes. Those are the only kind of people I want counting my money. Nobody else. Besides that, I tell you something else. I think that guy's lazy, and it's probably not his fault because laziness is a trait in blacks. John O'Donnell, a former president of Trump Plaza Hotel and Casino in Atlantic City, quoted Trump saying to him in his 1991 book, in May 1997, Trump was asked about his comment during an interview with Playboy, and he confirmed that the stuff O'Donnell wrote about was probably true. On the president, the 44th president, Barack Obama, he doesn't have a birth certificate. Or if he does, there's something on that certificate that is very bad for him. Now, somebody told me, and I have no idea if this is bad for him or not, but perhaps it would be, that where it says religion, it might have Muslim. And if you're a Muslim, you don't change your religion, by the way. That was on an appearance in 2011 on the Laura Ingraham show. He said that women who have abortions should be punished. He mocked a handicapped person with a jolting pantomime. He said he's allowed to grab women by the pussy because he's famous. He chose a vice president who has actively tried to reduce the rights of LGBTQ citizens and a cabinet who wants to reshape the country to help the greediest among us rather than work to keep the ever-dwindling American dream alive for anyone. The dialogue from Trump supporters are laced with anti-immigrant, anti-women, and anti-gay sentiments. In the battle for the American character, neo-Nazis have reemerged, hate speech is back in fashion, and regressive ideas have support among a larger swath of the country than many of us thought possible. America is toying with the idea of redefining itself in the most drastic terms since World War II. When we march, it's not because we don't know that Mr. Trump is president. It's not because we are sore losers or whining babies. It's because the victories we hold dear are at risk of being dismantled. It's because we don't want anything to be taken for granted. It's because we are American and care enough to fight for her character. It's because we value some things over wealth or security or religious definitions of morality. It's because we are willing to take the new administration at its word when it says that women should have less access to birth control and healthcare resources. We believe Trump when he suggests we must greatly strengthen and expand its nuclear capability, and Mike Pence when he says societal collapse was always brought about following an advent of the deterioration of marriage and family. We believe he means it when he calls being gay a choice and says keeping gays from marrying is not discrimination, but an enforcement of God's idea. We march to remind power that we are still here, and that we will not stand by silently while our neighbors are demonized or forcibly removed. We will not keep our head down while people who are still adjusting to open acceptance of their sexuality are bullied. We will not look away when women are objectified or have their rights weakened by Washington misogyny. We will help define the American character as one that is greater than the sum of its parts. A character that is made up of all citizens and has room for all of them. Christians and atheists, homosexuals and heterosexuals, liberals and conservatives, Muslims and Mexicans and white guys and women of all shapes and colors. We like our tapestry intact, thank you very much. And we will happily demonstrate our love for its rainbow of colors and its spectrum of ideologies. All right, that just about sums up my thoughts this week on America. And now for the worst possible transition, we're going to try to jump from that over to Scientology, the actual grand topic of the week. Scientology has been around for a little over half a century now. What we really found interesting about it is it's one of the two truly American religions, the first being Mormonism. These are religions that were born inside of the United States after the foundation of the United States. They don't come from some ancient nation, some old culture. They come from right here. And while Mormonism is based on the older monotheisms, it's kind of the fourth Abrahamic religion after Islam. Scientology builds all of its mythology internally. It all ends up coming, more or less, from one guy. There's no earlier version of it that they're borrowing from or building upon as a framework. Instead, we can trace all of its teachings, the entire mythology, the way that it operates, back to an individual named L. Ron Hubbard. This guy is fascinating. He is truly fascinating and very, very American. And we thought that what we would do here is we would begin our conversation about Scientology with the man himself, L. Ron Hubbard. He was born Lafayette Ronald Hubbard in 1911 in Nebraska, but he grew up in Helena, Montana. That's not so awful far away from where I live. I've been to Helena several times. Biographical accounts published by the Church of Scientology describe Hubbard as a child prodigy of sorts who rode a horse before he could walk and was able to read and write by the age of four. This is interesting to me because it's common when you have a prophet or an ecclesiastical teacher in a religion to promote them up into having some kind of ability, some kind of power, some kind of legend that seems too good to be true, and you write that right into the myth of who this character is.
Yeah, the church insists that his grandfather was a wealthy rancher from who L. Ron Hubbard inherited his fortune from, but in reality, Hubbard's grandfather was a veterinarian and was not wealthy. Hubbard grew up in a townhouse, not on the ranch.
Now, this young man did become an Eagle Scout 2 weeks after his 13th birthday. That is remarkable. That is impressive. To be able to do that, I was a Cub Scout, and then for like a very brief sliver of time, a Boy Scout. And, you know, I was the idea of becoming an Eagle Scout, which is quite an achievement for anyone, at the age of 13. That's really something. That's
pretty impressive.
I mean,
I was a Cub Scout and I couldn't hack that really. I didn't even go to the Boy Scouts, but several of my sergeants in the Army were actually Boy Scouts. So it is a remarkable accomplishment at 13. He traveled in the late 1920s, including the Guam, the Philippines, Japan, and China. He disdained the poverty of the inhabitants of Japan and China, whom he described as gooks and lazy and ignorant. A quote from L. Ron Hubbard, "A Chinaman cannot live up to a thing. He always drags it down." He characterized sites of Beijing as rubberneck stations for tourists and described the place, the palaces of the Forbidden City, as very trashy looking and not worth mentioning. He says, "They smell of all the baths they didn't take. The trouble with China is there are too many chinks here."
How gross is that?
It's pretty bad.
I mean, you know, in the 1920s, perhaps it wasn't that rare to use terms like chinks and gooks.
Right.
But still, to actually go and not be ethnocentric, to actually go and hang out in these places, to journey around in China and see it for himself, and still be able to be so
right.
He just boils it down to nothing.
That's what struck me about this quote was even saying, all right, let's give it the times, 1920s, like people will say now, well, it's grandma and that's just the way they talk back then. Even excluding that, giving them that in the 20s, it wasn't rare to say things like gook or chink. The idea of being there, like you're saying, being there yourself and to look at the Forbidden City palaces and think to yourself, those are trashy looking. I mean, I haven't had the opportunity to be there myself, but I've seen images of the Forbidden City's palaces and they are breathtakingly beautiful, in my opinion.
It's impressive. Yeah.
I don't know how, and so far before most civilizations. So for you to just, to me, it's showing this just ingrained bias that he already has, that he is not willing to overlook. Even when he sees it, he's not struck by beauty. He's just like, you, they made it. So it
right.
must be trashy because I see them as trash anyway.
Right. It's clearly lesser because it was made by the
right.
Chinese. This attitude too, that there must be some kind of fundamental flaw. A Chinaman cannot live up to a thing. He always drags it down. Like, you can't really generalize more than that. You're noticing something negative, some kind of trait that you think you can identify in all Chinese people.
Right.
It's a gross narrative from the start.
It opens up the door for that, in his worldview, they wouldn't even be needed on the planet because they never will be able to accomplish anything. They could only serve to bog society down and bring it backwards. So in
there
his worldview, it seems to me that he just doesn't even want them here.
Mr. Hubbard failed the Naval Academy entrance examination, but then he enrolled at the Swavely Preparatory School in Manassas, Virginia, to prepare him for a second attempt at the examination. However, he was ruled out of consideration due to his nearsightedness. Finally, he decided that with pressure from his father, that he would go and study civil engineering during 2 years at George Washington University, but he dropped out of that institution in 1932 after being put on academic probation. He said that he hated being in class. He didn't have any interest in actually engaging with the academia, and so he would just not go.
Yeah, and the Scientology Church accounts that he studied nuclear physics at George Washington University in Washington, D.C., before he started his studies about the mind, spirit, and life. And Hubbard himself stated that he set out to find out from nuclear physics a knowledge of the physical universe, something entirely lacking in Asian philosophy. His university records indicate, though, that his exposure to nuclear physics consisted of one class in atomic molecular phenomena for which he earned an F grade.
According to church materials, There's this constant attempt from what we've been reading so far of the church to hold this guy up as just being incredible. He did all of this stuff for the first time. Anything he tried his hand at, he just blew everybody else away. He was this Renaissance man, this figure, you know, a jack of all trades. Anything that he put his mind to just came to him.
And he excelled at it and added to what was already known about it.
Making discoveries all along the way, putting everybody else to shame.
Yeah.
He's
you know, when you're saying that he didn't even have a, like, he didn't like going to class, he didn't like the academia of it, and then he takes this, he wants to learn about life, you know, through, to apply it to his ideas of studying the mind through nuclear physics, but he failed the class. But it seems to me that I don't think he even minds in class. I think he didn't want to go there and learn, like you're saying. He wasn't interested in it. He wanted to go there and get anything that he could out of it, extract nuggets from it that would help him support his already predetermined worldview.
Right, right. Any little, if I touch it, I can then tell everybody that I'm an expert at it.
Right.
It's like he's collecting credentials.
Yeah, he's building his ethos.
According to church materials, he finally decides to go and be a pilot. They say that he earned his wings as a pioneering barnstormer at the dawn of American aviation and was recognized as one of the country's most outstanding pilots. With virtually no training time, he takes up powered flight and barnstorms through the Midwest. According to his airman certificate, it records that he qualified to fly only gliders, not powered aircraft, and that he gave up his certificate when he could not afford the renewal fee. this we've like barely started on L. Ron Hubbard, and there's already a constant trend of well, I did a thing, and I was the best ever at that thing.
Yeah, the church says that he was the best after or best ever at those things, and I'm sure that he, you know, his persona as he developed the religion propagated that. But it seems to me that the pattern we're developing right now at the early age is that he starts something, doesn't finish it because he's no good at it, and then moves on, dismissing it as not important anyway. He goes on an expedition in 1932 intending to film pirates and collect artifacts for museum exhibits. The trip was plagued with troubles and ultimately went bankrupt. He brought specimens and photographs collected by the expedition and they're said by the Scientology to have been acquired by the University of Michigan, the U.S. Hydrographic Office, an unspecified National Museum, and the New York Times, through one of those institutions, have any record of this.
Zafar is helping us out in the chat. She actually found the lie about being a nuclear physicist. He said, "I happen to be a nuclear physicist. I am not a psychologist, nor a psychiatrist, nor a medical doctor." That was in a 1952 lecture, Dianetics, the Modern Miracle. So took one class and failed it. I'm a nuclear physicist.
Yeah. To learn to fly our guiders, I'm the best pilot ever.
After leaving university, Hubbard traveled to Puerto Rico on what the Church of Scientology calls the Puerto Rican Mineralogical Expedition. Scientologists claim he made the first complete mineralogical survey of Puerto Rico as a means of augmenting his father's pay with a mining venture, during which he sluiced inland rivers and crisscrossed the island in search of elusive gold, as well as carrying out much ethnological work amongst the interior villages and native hillsmen. Hubbard's unofficial biographer, Russell Miller, writes that neither the United States Geological Survey nor the Puerto Rican Department of Natural Resources have any record of any such expedition.
So that's two expeditions that haven't happened. Or there's no
right.
record of collecting anything from or them being successful in any way.
Perhaps he touched Puerto Rico at some point. And then he can't help. It's almost like he's a pathological liar. He can't help it. He's got to inflate his ego. He's got to he needs to make a legend of himself.
Mm.
According to author Jay Fox, a contributor to John W. Campbell's Astounding Magazine, Hubbard told a 1948 convention of science fiction fans that a book that he wrote called Excalibur. The inspiration for this book came during an operation in which he died for 8 minutes. Jerry Armstrong, Hubbard's archivist, explains this as a dental extraction performed under nitrous oxide, which of course is a chemical known for its hallucinogenic effects.
Yeah, Hubbard realized that while he was dead, he had received a tremendous inspiration, a great message which he must impart to others. He sat at his typewriter for 6 days and nights, and nothing came out. Then Excalibur emerged. Arthur J. Banks, the president of the American Fiction Guild, wrote that an excited Hubbard called him and said, I want to see you right away. I have written the book. Hubbard believed that Excalibur would revolutionize everything and that it was somewhat more important and would have a greater impact upon people than the Bible. It proposed that all human behavior could be explained in terms of survival and that to understand survival was to understand life. As Hubbard biographer John Attack notes, the notion that everything that exists is trying to survive became the basis of Dianetics and Scientology.
I love that. I have written the book. He's convinced this is
I don't even think the authors of the Bible were like, this is the book, you know? The Gideons may call it the book and put it in every hotel they can. But to write it and, like, you know, you just put down the pen, or you just stretch out your fingers and then you call up your friend.
The Bible was written by lots of people over a long period of time.
Right. They wouldn't even have the opportunity to get together and claim it as such.
This book just poured right out of him. Now he had been writing for a little while. Hubbard, especially in the early years, was chronically broke. And he was pretty good at fiction. In fact, he knew Isaac Asimov. He knew some of the other sci-fi writers of his day, and they seemed to have gotten along somewhat. They seem to have been all right with each other, though they're not really mentioned later on. Once he's actually talking about Dianetics and stuff, they don't really seem to be as involved. But he would, you know, we were quoting somebody who was writing about Astounding Magazine. He would write pulp fiction. This was like his day job. He would. There are several other magazines like this too, where, you know, they're like little dime magazines that you would buy, and they would just be full of hastily constructed, quickly printed pulp fiction, science fiction, fantasy, sometimes even romance. And he would go and he would pump this stuff out. Now, he was getting paid a lot of times a penny a word, so he had to write a lot in order to make any kind of money. And so he would just sit down and write and write and write and write. In order to meet deadlines and to make as much money as he possibly could. There's an anecdote about how he would write so frantically. He would just sit there and type on his typewriter so fast that he would sweat, and the sweat from his brow would fall into the typewriter and jam it up. It would stain the paper, and it would fuck up what he was doing. So he would get several of them prepared, because he would like type until he broke a typewriter. And then he would just move to the next one and keep going, because he didn't want to stop. He would, once he had an idea, he was incredibly prolific. He would just get an idea and punch out like 100,000 words a month, just constantly producing all of this content. And a lot of it, you know, it's not like he's taking the time to build a story structure and figure out all the things that he wants to say and build the exact story ahead of time and then write it with some kind of expertise. He's reasonably talented at writing, and so he's just coming up with ideas and punching them up at breakneck speed.
It's all first drafts.
Exactly.
And you know, this leads to that, what is it, Guinness Book of World Records. Like, he holds a record for most published books of all time, something like 1,000 books.
Yeah, most published books of all time. He's considered the most prolific author in history. Scientology doctrine alone consists of over 20 million words written by Hubbard. That's a huge amount. 20 million words is insane. He also, just as a side note, he also holds the world record for the most audiobooks ever published for a single author. Although I don't think that he was, that he was like recording them himself. They did them.
He's not the narrator for them.
Yeah. That would be kind of sweet though. Actually hearing L. Ron Hubbard read L. Ron Hubbard.
Oh man. Because then you could hear the love, for himself.
Yeah. Yeah. You'd be able to hear, you know, where I'd like to hear, like, where does he put the emphasis on his words, and does he get excited about the story and get all amped up about it? Or does he read it monotone? How can he control his diction during all of that? By most accounts, he was at least scatterbrained. Some people, including his son, have said that they think he's mentally, like, he's not balanced. There's something wrong with his brain. Other people, of course, think he was just a genius, and this is how it manifested itself.
There's a fine line between genius and insanity.
Truly, truly there is. He wrote this book, Excalibur, the one that he said would revolutionize everything, the thing that he called the book. This is still fairly early. as Scott said, this ends up going on to become the basis of Dianetics. He hasn't even gotten to Dianetics yet, which is like book one of Scientology.
Right.
Everything was very, very important in the moment. He wrote this story and just got so into it that he thought, oh, this is the greatest thing ever. According to the president of the American Fiction Guild, Arthur Burks, Hubbard was so sure he had something away out and beyond anything else that he had sent telegrams to several book publishers telling them again that he had written the book and that they were to meet him at Penn Station and he would discuss it with them and go with whomever gave him the best offer. However, nobody bought the manuscript. Forrest J. Ackerman, later Hubbard's literary agent, recalled that Hubbard told him, "Whoever read it either went insane or committed suicide." And he said that the last time he had shown it to a publisher in New York, he walked into the office to find out what the reaction was. The publisher called for the reader. The reader came in with the manuscript, threw it down on the table, and threw himself out of the skyscraper window. Just reading this is so revolutionary and so crazy that the human mind snaps upon reading it. It's so powerful, this book Excalibur, that people are either going insane or committing suicide when they read it. Hubbard thinks that he witnessed a guy throw himself through a window.
He actually just like done and out the window, and he watched this happen.
Dive. Yeah, right. He was actually a witness to this event, apparently. His failure to sell Excalibur depressed him. He told his wife in a letter. He wrote a letter in October of 1938 to his wife saying, "Writing action pulp doesn't have much agreement with what I want to do because it retards my progress by demanding incessant attention and, further, actually weakens my name. So you see, I've got to do something about it and at the same time strengthen the old financial position." He went on, "Sooner or later, Excalibur will be published, and I may have a chance to get some name recognition out of it, so as to pave the way to articles and comments which are my ideas of writing heaven, foolishly perhaps, but determined nonetheless. I have high hopes of smashing my name into history so violently that it will take a legendary form, even if all books are destroyed. This goal is the real goal, as far as I am concerned."
It's interesting to me that the fault in Excalibur not being published at that time or not being taken at the time is not the writing. It's not his own. It's the fact that he's bogged down with his attention elsewhere on this other stuff to earn money. And that, as you can tell from the thing above, that it's just the regular human minds that try to read it that can't comprehend it and go insane and kill themselves. It has nothing to do with him or the writing. That's not why it failed.
Right. He surely would have sold it if these weak-minded fools had only been able to handle the amazing things that he had written down on paper. I'm gonna read this again. "I have high hopes of smashing my name into history so violently that it will take a legendary form, even if all books are destroyed. That goal is the real goal, as far as I am concerned." He is obsessed with becoming famous, and not just like Hollywood famous, not just popular, but legendary in a historical sense.
Changing the way society operates.
Right. He wants to make discoveries. He wants to find something that makes him a name like Freud. Like, he wants to become an absolute historical figure. And that goal is the real goal. I mean, from the beginning, he hasn't even started the church yet.
No. The idea hasn't probably even occurred to him yet.
Unbelievable. The manuscript later became part of Scientology mythology. An early 1950s Scientology publication offered signed, gold-bound, and locked copies of Excalibur for the sum of $1,500 apiece. Today, that would be about $29,000 It also warned that 4 of the first 15 people who read it went insane, and that it would be released only on sworn statement not to permit other readers to read it. Contains data not to be released during Mr. Hubbard's stay on Earth.
It just flashed in my mind the I don't know why, but the movie Scrooged, when he runs the trailer for his Scrooged, and it's not the nicey trailer that they want, but it's like showing all this horrible stuff, murders and crack addicts and everything. And then later on, he gets a copy of a newspaper saying that a woman had a heart attack while watching his ad that he put out. And he kind of bends his head down and he goes, "This is terrific. I want that ad run every hour on the hour with a disclaimer saying people who have a heart condition should leave the room immediately." It's a brilliant PR scam to just draw attention to it. But
right,
not concerned with safety at all.
No, it's just good. But if a few people die to promote a film, that's fine.
That's fine.
You know, people are going insane just from reading this text, and that's a selling point for him. I love this idea that it's so powerful that a certain combination of English words on printed paper is so powerful that you have to lock the book. Might as well sell it for thousands and thousands of dollars. But you know, beware that if you do read it and don't read it until after he's dead, you very well might go insane. You got a 1 in 3 chance, basically, of going insane if you dare unlock your $30,000 book.
Yeah. Hubbard defined perversion in his 1951 book, Science of Survival, Prediction of Human Behavior, where he introduced the concept of the tone scale, a means of classifying individuals and human behavior on a chart running from plus 40, the most beneficial, to minus 40, the least beneficial. Sexual perversion, a category in which he included homosexuality, was termed covert hostility and given a score of 1.1. The level of the pervert, the hypocrite, the turncoat, the subversive. He considered such people to be skulking cowards who yet contain enough perfidious energy to strike back, but not enough courage ever to give warning. Hubbard urged society to tackle the issue of sexual perversion, including homosexuality, calling it of vital importance if one wishes to stop immorality and the abuse of children. In The Science of Survival, he called for drastic action to be taken against sexual perverts, whom he rated as 1.1 individuals.
Such people should be taken from the society as rapidly as possible and uniformly institutionalized. For here is the level of the contagion of immorality and the destruction of ethics. Here is the fodder which secret police organizations use for their filthy operations. One of the most effective measures of security that a nation threatened by war could take would be rounding up and placing in a containment away from society any 1.1 individual who might be connected with government, the military, or essential industry, since there are people who, regardless of any record of their family's loyalty, are potential traitors, the very mode of operation of their insanity being betrayal. In this level is the slime of society, the sex criminals, the political subversives, the people whose apparently rational activities are yet but the devious writhings of secret hate. That's
no, go ahead. I'm just
that's fascism.
Well, there's like, yeah, and like it rings of eugenics.
Right. Yeah, it's practically Orwellian in some senses. Like, even if the family swears loyalty, there are still potential traitors because one of them might be gay.
Right. It's potential. They haven't done anything yet, but the fact that they probably think that way.
The idea that one deluded man could use a twisted and limited interpretation of psychology to determine the numerical value of human beings and then further declare that they should be locked up in concentration camps is dangerous enough. But when married to religious doctrine, it becomes downright evil. Okay. This basically brings us to Dianetics. We've established that L. Ron Hubbard is a pathological liar. He's basically a narcissist. He's obsessed with himself. Sure. His ego knows no bounds. He must build this legend of himself. He is desperate to smash himself violently into the history books, to make discoveries that no one else has made. And everyone that he claims is debunked, is rejected as not being true, and isn't quite big enough for what he wants. It also isn't paying very well. You know, being the first guy to do a geographical survey of Puerto Rico wasn't bringing in a lot of monthly income.
Yeah, he's the first guy to completely do the mineralogical tables for the entire place. Yeah,
right. So he's toyed with this and that. He's figured out that he needs to become hugely, hugely famous. He's wrote Excalibur, which basically, as the book, as the thing that's going to be more impactful on humans than the Bible itself. Even bigger than the Bible, like the Beatles, bigger than Jesus. He's creating a narrative in Excalibur where everything can be explained by the drive for survival. Everything can be boiled down to our need to survive, a desire to survive. And he builds that in as if it's psychology. Again, almost Freudian. Like you can look at any behavior and you can determine that behavior can be guessed at and predicted because we can understand what makes people want to survive. And then that morphs into this idea that we can numerically value people on this scale that he invented as to whether or not they are going to help the rest of society prevail in its attempt to survive.
If they're
going to
be beneficial. It's almost like trying to implement a Darwinian kind of thing. Like what the theology rails against with atheism is that, oh, you just want to live in a Darwinian world system. That would be horrible. And we typically agree, yeah, it would be if it was just who can live and who can't. That would be a horrible place to live. And it seems like that's what he's trying to build society on, is who's beneficial, who could live, and who doesn't matter.
When we tie all these things together, I think we can see what was going on in this person's head as he came up with his next attempt, building on the ideas of Excalibur, convincing himself that you know what he dreamed up while getting a tooth extracted and then expounded upon
right.
in his internal worldview.
Get it right. It wasn't just a tooth extracted. He died. 8 minutes.
He died for 8 minutes, right. He died for 8 minutes and things were revealed to him. He's already got some prejudice issues. He doesn't like people in China. You know, we're not big fans of gay people. There must be something wrong with the world. And perhaps we could come up with a kind of sort of psychology adjacent way of dealing with the world's problems. And out of this fire is forged Dianetics. And this word comes from the Greek dia, meaning through, and nous, meaning mind. It's a set of ideas and practices regarding the metaphysical relationship between the mind and body. Dianetics is practiced by followers of Scientology, of course, but there are also independent Dianeticist groups. And this is something that I learned about like a few hours ago. Scientology, small as it is, and new as it is, doesn't have a lock on this stuff. There are other groups in the world that are not associated with Scientology, and in fact, some of them have been sued by Scientology for printing materials about Dianetics without the proper copyright. And these groups also believe in Dianetics. They just don't fall in with all of the other, you know, the weird stuff that Scientology is into. They do their own thing separate from that. Any churchman, any church will have groups splinter off. You're going to have denominations. It's going to happen. Dianetics has achieved no acceptance as a scientific theory and is widely considered to be pseudoscience. Dianetics divides the mind into three parts: the conscious analytical mind, the subconscious reactive mind, and the somatic mind. The goal of Dianetics is to erase the content of the reactive mind, which Scientologists believe interferes with a person's ethics, awareness, happiness, and sanity. The Dianetics procedure to achieve this erasure is called auditing. In auditing, the Dianetic auditor asks a series of questions or commands and elicits answers to help a person locate and deal with painful experiences of the past, which Scientologists believe to be the content of the reactive mind. This is where we should probably take a moment and say, Scientologists totally believe in reincarnation. I actually looked this up on the official Scientology website, and they have a lot of flowery language. There's this tactic that they use where they will often compare themselves to other religions. Like, well, any religion makes crazy claims, so we do too. Any religion is concerned with the origin of the universe, that's why we do it. Like, they never say what we're saying is true. They always say other stuff is weird, so it's okay for our stuff to be weird. That's how they sell it. They just lump it in with all of the other ridiculous. This is part of why religion is kind of generally a bad idea from where I'm standing. Now, they make the point to say that there are two kinds of reincarnation. There's the kind that we kind of, you know, it's almost like the one that's tied with karma, where you can be reincarnated in a different form. Like, maybe you're a good human, and so afterwards you get to be a richer human, or you're a real shitbag, and so you end up coming back as like a dog or an insect or something like that.
Yeah.
And if you do better in that form during your next life, then maybe you can move back up the ladder. There's like this sliding scale where you're always being punished or rewarded by the reincarnation system to make you, you know, to reward you with a body that fits your principle. Scientology doesn't go for that one. They go for the alternative definition, which suggests that you're always reincarnated as another person. You die as a human being. It doesn't matter if you're good or bad. You come back as another human being, and another human being, and another human being after that. So
right.
They completely subscribe to that version of reincarnation.
Practitioners of Dianetics believe that the basic principle of existence is to survive, and that the basic personality of humans is sincere, intelligent, and good. The drive for goodness and survival is distorted and inhabited by aberrations ranging from simple neuroses to different psychotic states to various kinds of sociopathic behavior patterns. Hubbard developed Dianetics, claiming that it could eradicate these aberrations.
The idea, and we're gonna get to the stuff that most people already know about Scientology in a bit. We're gonna get to the actual mythology, the stupefying, gleeful insanity of their story, and that does tie directly into explaining why this process is required. But basically what they're saying is that by interviewing people in a certain way and applying this psychological idea that you've got to reject these memories from former lives, you can become a better person. That anything that's in your way as an individual, anything that's harming you, anything that's keeping you from achieving your dreams is because of part of your brain remembering stuff that you don't understand, and that's causing problems for a couple of reasons that we will expound upon fairly shortly. It really is. Yeah, all of this is just the first coat. We got the really whoa shit is yet to come. There was this quote, and it was from a guy in Scientology. And he was talking about what he would do when he was out trying to recruit people. And he would try to explain these generals and say, basically, whatever you're trying to achieve that you can't achieve, that's because you haven't gone through the Dianetics process yet. If you're trying to get that great job and you haven't made it yet, if you're trying to break into Hollywood and become an actor and it's not working for you, if you're struggling with your studies, if you're, you know, trying to get somebody to marry you, whatever your problem is, wink, wink, the concern here, we can fix all that as long as we apply Dianetics to you. We've got to do this auditing. We've got to get you going on that. It's classic. It's whatever your problem is, I can explain why it's a problem and I can fix it. Come with me. His quote was, "It's an applied religious philosophy, not just something to pray at an altar about." There's this proactive element, right? It's kind of like the power of positive thinking, but also with a whole bunch of pseudoscience bullshit attached to it. It's all right. It's kind of like motivational speaking,
and sort of sets up the groundwork for putting it on you. If it fails, it wasn't it. It was you not utilizing it properly.
If this works, so if you're not getting it,
right,
that's clearly your fault. It's a lot like some of the theologies. You got to want to believe in order to believe. If you accept it all as true, then you'll understand how it's true. When you're doing auditing, they use this technology called an E-meter. An E-meter is one third of a lie detector. Basically, it reads electrodermal activity. So if you have an instrument that can measure it, we produce electricity as human beings. And you can feel it on the, not like with your hand, but you can sense it in the skin. It's called electrodermal activity. When you use an E-meter, you hold on to basically two objects. In the old days, they were just aluminum cans. They've you know, made it a little fancier these days, but it's the principle is the same. You hold these two conductors in your hands, and that completes a circuit with your electrodermal current, and then you plug a needle into that on a gauge, and as you talk, you know, that electric field might fluctuate, change a little bit here and there. And so they mark down when that changes compared matched up to what it is that you're saying. So if you say something and the needle moves a little bit, it's very, very sensitive. If it moves a little bit from the auditor's perspective, then obviously that must mean that you have found an engram, you have found some memory, you have found something that we need to talk about in order to get rid of it by applying Dianetics.
That you just put too much focus on.
If you added a respiratory monitor and a heart rate monitor, you would have a lie detector. They just don't bother with those two things. The lie detectors are already notoriously untrustworthy. You can't use them in court. But this is only a third of that. Like it doesn't even have the extra stuff attached to it.
It's a third as trustworthy as the already not trustworthy one.
Exactly. If you needed any evidence that this is complete pseudoscience, you know, you can build this in your garage. And
here's this thing that's completely not even admissible in court because it's so inaccurate. And let's take a third of it and base our worldview off of that.
Right. They make claims about it that it actually measures the mass of thoughts.
The mass of thoughts.
The mass of thoughts, like they're tangible. As if you could do such a thing, if you could measure thought. it's. I mean, any level of critical thinking here breaks Dianetics pretty easily. But before we get too far into why auditing is something that you would want to do in the first place, we need to explain the basics of what Scientologists believe.
Scientologists affirm the existence of a deity without defining or describing its nature. L. Ron Hubbard explains in his book, Science of Survival, no culture in the history of the world, save the thoroughly depraved and expiring ones, has failed to affirm the existence of a supreme being. It is an empirical observation that men without a strong and lasting faith in a supreme being are less capable, less ethical, and less valuable. Instead of defining God, members assert that reaching higher states of enlightenment will enable individuals to make their own conclusions about the supreme being. And then I don't know if you guys are familiar with it, if you've seen any Scientology buildings or the website or whatever, they have a symbol. It's two triangles kind of pointing to the right with an S in between them. They are the ARC and KRC triangles. They are concept maps which show a relationship among three concepts to form another concept. The KRC triangle is the uppermost triangle. It combines the components of knowledge, responsibility, and control. The Scientologist must gain knowledge of, take responsibility for, and effectively exert control over elements of his or her environment. The ARC triangle is the lower triangle. It is a summary representation of the knowledge of Scientology that a Scientologist strives for. It combines three components. Affinity is a degree of affection, love, or liking, like an emotional state. Reality reflects consensual reality, that is, agreements on what is real. And communication, believed to be the most important element of the triangle, is the exchange of ideas. Scientologists believe that improving one of the three aspects of the ARC triangle, increasing the level of the other two, must be important aspects of this triangle. The most important aspect of this triangle is communication, mainly because communication drives the other two aspects, affinity and reality. Scientologists believe that ineffective communication is a chief cause of human survival problems, and this is reflected by efforts at all levels within the movement to ensure clear communication, the presence of unabridged standard dictionaries, for example, being an established feature of Scientology centers. Scientologists believe that the three elements are fundamental between individuals in that to communicate with a person, one must have some affinity for him or her. As Dorothy Resfield Christensen describes it, according to Scientology doctrine, the break in the flow of ARC that hinders survival must be handled in auditing. The two triangles are connected by the letter S, standing for Scio, Latin for I know. Church of Scientology doctrine defines Scio as knowing in the fullest sense of the word. It links the two triangles together.
Scio. This is where... And we were talking to some friends of ours over the last couple of nights as we were kind of delving into this and trying to process it, you know, little by little. We were like breaking off chunks and then commenting and trying to digest it. And we were talking with some of our friends, and there was a general sense, especially after reading this, that it's kind of appealing.
Yeah, there's an aspect in taking control of yourself and your environment and, improving your communication with the people that you do have affinity for, that you have affection for. You want to be clear and concise in the way you talk to them. You want to be confident in the way that you handle your environment and the situations around you. So there's an absolutely appealing aspect to it, for sure.
It's like self-help. And there's obviously for a long time been a big market for that, how to be more assertive, how to get the things that you want, how to express your deepest desire, whatever it is. That's like really, really common. And it's very American. The self-help concept, I'm sure that it exists elsewhere as well, but it seems to be a big, big deal here. Every bookstore I've ever been in has had a self-help section. And this is kind of playing to that, this idea that whatever it is that you're missing, wherever you feel you're weak, we can make it better, or rather you can make it better, and we can show you how.
Yeah. The roots of Scientology are tangled up in self-help, science fiction, and I think a little mysticism. Much like a tree growing too close to a fence, the tree grows around and encompasses the fence and post until they become one. The fence isn't a typical aspect of the tree. The tree would be fine on its own. It doesn't need the strength of the fence, but there's no doubt that this relationship adds a bit of stability to both the tree and the fence. The religion of Scientology has grown up so close to science and science fiction that it grew around those concepts and claims them as its own to strengthen its position on the world stage as a viable view of reality.
We had a question from R. Hamilton X. He asked, why were early believers so convinced by this obvious con man? it seems like, well, I guess we talked about that a little bit, just in most people have some problem. We kind of naturally feel like, oh, there's always something more. The grass is always greener and all of those notions. But that question, I mean, why does anybody, why is it that the vast majority of the human population is eager to be conned by various theologies? Scientology is a small one.
For sure.
Do we think that Scientology, that these ideas are playing on the same desire to believe that are felt by Christians and Muslims and Hindus and so forth?
It seems that it does, like, on the face of it. Like other cults, they get the people who are disenfranchised with something in their life, some aspect of their life or some aspect of society. And I think that they're just so willing to go, like you're saying, to the obvious con man, because at least this is an answer. Like, this is giving me some kind of answer, whereas the I don't know is too scary for, I assume, a majority of people.
Right. We're very inquisitive. Humans are very curious about things. We want to control our environment. We want to understand our environment. And it's kind of beyond our natural senses to just fit it all together. We need science and research and experimentation in order to discover principles. I mean, we were still playing with what exactly gravity is, you know, like a few hundred years ago. We're always trying to understand more things. And I think that's natural. I think that humans are inherently explorers, and we like to explore, not just like going into the jungle or crossing, North America, like Lewis and Clark did, but we also want to explore just the basic nature of reality. We want to explore how things operate. And when we don't have those answers and we want them, we're willing to turn to extraordinary answers because it helps us sleep at night. It makes us more satisfied. When Dianetics was first published, it exploded. You know, he thought that he would have some modest success with it. I forget the numbers now. He only planned on like 15,000 copies or something, and it skyrocketed to near the top, like 4 or 5 on the New York Times bestsellers list, and stayed there. It became like in the 50s, like a national craze. It was like a fad. Everybody was talking about it. L. Ron Hubbard was traveling the country, giving speeches about it. He was doing all these talks at universities and campuses, town halls, whatever, collecting paying fees in order to describe how Dianetics was working. And that feeling is exactly what he was looking for. He was finally getting recognition he thought he deserved. He was finally famous. People were taking him seriously. They were convinced that Dianetics was real. And I think that while he was already basically convinced, that kind of reaffirmation, that kind of validation just gave him what he was, turned it into the cult-like ideas that followed.
You and I watched a video in where he's talking about that, about Dianetics being on the number one seller list, and he's as giddy as a schoolgirl. I mean, he is just ear-to-ear smile, so pleased. And I mean, who wouldn't be? But, you know, when you're looking back as to what his goal was and how he wanted to smash his name into history, you can feel that coming right out of it.
Zafara makes a good point. She said it was not a religion at first either. It was a path to success. Yeah, exactly. It was a way of clearing your mind and a way of fixing whatever problems you had. It was about self-determination. It was about self-control and you know, unlocking your potential, so to speak. Hubbard introduced the Scientology cross in the 1950s as the central symbol for the church. It didn't take long for him to get that kind of attention and decide that he should move forward. Eventually the phase died, the craze died down, and people, you know, they had read it and they had tried it, and You know, not everybody had an e-meter. Not everybody was having that confessional kind of catharsis that one gets when you're sitting across from someone and telling them all about your deepest memories, and they're reinforcing anything that you make up and blending the lines, blurring the lines between imagination and actual memory. It began to lose steam, and he was very concerned about that. He was quoted as saying to his wife that the only way to make any real money in this world is to have a religion. And as he was watching Dianetics kind of slip a bit in the American zeitgeist, he thought, oh, the best way to move forward here is to double down, re-solidify this, and make it into a church. Turn it into a religion. Make it something that can survive past the fleeting attention of the population. So in the 50s, he created this central symbol. He described the 8 points of the cross as symbolizing the 8 dynamics or 8 measures for survival that all human beings have, which includes the urge to service as a spiritual being and the urge to survive as a godlike entity. Hubbard writes that survival is moving away from death and towards immortality, and that human beings are constantly on the search for feelings of pleasure and motivated by the avoidance of pain. What we want to do here is we want to read the 8 dynamics to you. The first dynamic is the urge towards survival of self, the idea that he first talked about in Excalibur, reinvented in Dianetics, and then republished afterwards as he formed the church. The first dynamic being just the urge towards survival of self.
The second dynamic is the urge towards survival through sex or children. This dynamic actually has 2 divisions. The second dynamic A is the sexual act itself. And the second dynamic B is the family unit, including the rearing of children.
The third dynamic is the urge towards survival through a group of individuals or as a group. Any group or part of an entire class could be considered to be a part of the third dynamic. The school, the club, the team, the town, the nation are examples of groups.
Now, the fourth dynamic is the urge towards survival through all mankind as all mankind.
The fifth is the urge towards survival through life forms such as animals, birds, insects, fish, and vegetation, and is the urge to survive as these.
The sixth dynamic is the urge towards survival as the physical universe and has its components matter, energy, space, and time, from which we derive the word MEST.
That's an important one. Remember that. MEST, matter, energy, space, and time, MEST. The seventh dynamic is the urge towards survival through spirits or as a spirit. Anything spiritual, with or without identity, would come under the seventh dynamic. A subheading of this dynamic is ideas and concepts such as beauty and the desire to survive through these.
The eighth dynamic is the urge towards survival through the supreme being, or more exactly, infinity.
It's difficult so far to pin down exactly what Scientology's attitudes are towards life after death, exactly how reincarnation happens, what mechanic determines how that works. There's very little. It's always kind of vague. We have found that Scientology is very good at talking a whole lot and saying nothing. The more that we compare what people who were in the church are saying to how the church itself represents its religion, the more you notice that they have a lot of verbiage, but there's not a whole lot actually being said. You can read it and you feel like you're reading something, and it's all very pretty. It's nice language, but it doesn't actually give you any information. There's very little knowledge actually coming out of this. Hubbard found some of his inspiration for some of the science of Scientology in science fiction writings. While it promotes science, it distorts it as well. Science fiction writer A.E. Van Vogt based the early development of Dianetics and Scientology on a novel based on general semantics, a pseudoscience created by Alfred Korzybski for the purpose of curing personal and social issues. There was an appetite for this. People were interested.
For a while, general semantics as a self-improvement and therapy program began in the 1920s. A long time. And that program, general semantics, sought to regulate human mental habits and behaviors. After partial launch, and it came out under different names originally, human engineering, it was called, and then humanology. And then the Polish-American originator, Alfred Korzybski, he fully launched a program as general semantics in 1933 with the publication of Science and Sanity, an introduction to non-Aristotelian systems and general semantics. In Science and Sanity, general semantics is presented as both a theoretical and practical system whose adoption can reliably after human behavior or alter human behavior in the direction of greater sanity.
In the 1947 preface to the third edition of Science and Sanity, Korzybski wrote, "We need not blind ourselves with the old dogma that human nature cannot be changed, for we find that it can be changed. However, in the opinion of a majority of psychiatrists, the tenets and practices of general semantics are not an effective way of treating patients with psychological or mental illnesses." While Korzybski considered his program to be empirically based and to strictly follow the scientific method, general semantics has been described as veering into the domain of pseudoscience.
Starting around 1940, university English professor S.I. Hayakawa, speech professor Wendell Johnson, speech professor Irving J. Lee, and others assembled elements of general semantics into a package suitable for incorporation into mainstream communication circular. The Institute of General Semantics, which Korzybski and co-workers founded in 1938, continues today. General semantics as a movement has waned considerably since the 1950s, although many of its ideas live on in other movements, such as neurolinguistic programming and rational emotive behavior therapy.
They're in the chat, and they're talking about Tom Cruise. We love Tom Cruise. Who doesn't love Tom Cruise?
Oh man, who doesn't?
I mean, you know, he's just fun. And we're about to shift gears yet again. So what we'll say now, we'll try to satisfy everybody's curiosity. What we intend to do in this episode is talk about the foundation, the origin, the beginning of this religion. And we're going to talk about the general mythology, the theology of this cult. And then what we're going to do is next week, we're going to talk about some of the individuals. Today we're talking about some L. Ron Hubbard, but there's so much more, you guys. There's so much stuff surrounding
this. This was going to be one episode, and it was going to cover it all, Miscavige and Cruz and Travolta and the whole deal. But as you start looking into it, there's just too much information. And I don't even know that two episodes is enough. We're already an hour and 15 minutes into this, and we haven't even got to the good stuff that we promised at the beginning.
Right. So we're gonna continue on and give you guys like a good rundown baseline. And then next week, we'll do the rest of L. Ron Hubbard. He's got this amazing military career that's just delightful to learn about. Some of the later stuff in his life, his misogyny and abuse. We're gonna talk about how Scientology became a religion, how it actually gained that that label under American law so that the IRS wouldn't tax him. We're going to talk about David Miscavige. He's, again, one of the most fascinating people that, I'm aware existing. I mean, this guy is so nuts. And then we'll talk about John Travolta. We'll talk about Tom Cruise. We'll talk about probably Marty Rathbun, some of the people that have left the church. There's a lot of information on that already. Some documentaries, there's a series going on. It might even still be on the air that talks to some of these people. We don't want to hit that too awful hard, but we do want to fill in all of the blanks that we leave in this episode. And we want to give you some more information about the deeper stuff, because a lot of people can tell you a few basic things about Scientology. It's fascinating, and we want to give you a deeper understanding. You should follow us at ISM_podcast on Twitter and on Periscope. Right now, the Periscope is live. We're going to shout out Young Athlon 399, who is helping us scope that right now. Cat is helping us by directing some of the comments and questions from those platforms to us so that we can stay engaged with you all. Follow me at Dopinephrine on Twitter and Periscope. Scott is L Duderino. That's ELDUDEIRENO. And if you want to call and be on the show, if you've got a question or a comment, you can get a hold of us at 646-564-9551. Now, before we proceed into this next subject, we have a disclaimer. L. Ron Hubbard said that anyone who was exposed to this information would casually freewheel through it, become a chronic insomniac, then get sick and die. Much of the mythology we are going to explain has been labeled as too dangerous for simple dissemination to the public. Its access is restricted to OT3s, people who have reached a very high level in the Scientology system. If you are not an OT3 or above, the Church of Scientology believes hearing the following is detrimental to your health. Been warned.
Well, and it's good that you put that up there, because when he wrote, you know, Excalibur, guys are just throwing themselves out the windows right in front of him. So you know that as he refines his the knowledge of it, it's just going to be too much for the common man to be able to handle.
You're going to need to buckle up for this stuff, guys. It's intense. I would sign your last will and testament now. You might want to just disengage from the show completely. This is not something to just be taken lightly. It's not for us simple people. This is only for OT3s and above.
The only reason we had this information is people like Marty Rathman that you talked about before, and other members, former members of the church, who have left. So it's time to get into Xenu and Thetans. Long before Xenu decided to turn Earth into a prison planet for everyone that he thought would rebel against his regime, there were disembodied energies floating throughout a universe of emptiness. In a work called Factors, 1953, Scientology founder L. Ron Hubbard describes the inception of Theta, or the energy that creates life itself. According to Scientology scriptures, in the beginning was a decision, and the decision was to be. From that point, this life energy came into existence with nothing else around. Eventually, it wanted something to look at, so it extended a viewpoint, thereby creating dimension. There were other life forms, which also started extending their viewpoints. Once they discovered each other, they decided to collaborate as a committee and create a universe called the Theta Universe for them to live in. Out of boredom, they created the MEST Universe. Remember the MEST, matter, energy, space, and time universe. The MEST Universe is a universe that we live in today.
Okay. I'm sure that everybody followed that perfectly. Okay. All right. So this is the origin story, according to Scientology. Christians think that God just spoke it into being, let there be light. Science explains it through the process of the Big Bang. There are various competing ways of explaining this. There are tribes that think that there was a great turtle that swam to the bottom of the ocean. and brought up little bits of dirt and added that to the surface until eventually it built a continent. And these people weren't thinking of like stars and stuff, but it's still their origin story. The origin story of Scientology, you know, comes from the 1950s, and it explains that in the beginning, there was a decision, not a word.
And the decision was to be. This kind of like answers the question that we often ask with this, where did God come from? So he's just like, well, I'm going to be now. And then was.
Right.
I was just thinking as I read through this just now was, it kind of made more sense this time around when I was thinking about that the eight tenets or the eight points of the cross, and there was that part where it says, you know, the survival instinct to survive as insects or animals or whatever, or to survive as beauty or whatever. So it's kind of referring to that life force, that life energy, just wants to survive, wants to be. So it just decided to be, then it was, and then it decided that it wanted to survive and do that as several different things. Anything that is tangible that we can view is just a form of that life energy surviving.
Sure. It also plays back into the idea of the self. Scientologists often talk about how it's about empowering you as an individual. You don't go and pray and join a club and all of that. You're supposed to be gaining tools so that you can express yourself better, so that you can become more self-aware, more powerful. And this kind of plays into that where the very first thing was a self-decision, something it's almost a play on the, I think, therefore I am. I desire to become, and therefore I became, is kind of the notion here.
And there's the God of the self, because the eighth dynamic is the urge toward survival through the supreme being, you know, or forever, surviving forever. Somehow the life force can become godlike in some way.
Right. Gaining abilities that we think of as supernatural.
Right.
Okay, so we've got this kind of sort of life force thing. It decides that it wants to exist, therefore it does. It gets bored, so it starts creating dimension. Somehow, there were other life forms. That's all it says, just somehow.
Yeah. Somehow there were
other life forms. So this original life force is looking into the dimension that it's just created out of boredom and discovers that there are other life forms there as well. They begin to extend their viewpoints. Once they discover each other, they decide to collaborate as a committee and create a universe called the Theta Universe. So everything is, I mean, there's one, it's almost, you begin solipsistically, you determine that you want to exist, you open your eyes, the simple act of doing so has created a plane in which you can exist. It is populated with other beings that are like you.
They're also extending their viewpoint and creating dimension. So together, all of you are expanding your viewpoint, creating a dimension for you to exist in and look around in. And yet there isn't a universe yet.
Right. There isn't actually a universe yet. All they've got is dimension. Okay.
Then they create the Theta Universe for themselves.
The Theta Universe would presumably be a place of pure thought.
Yes, the pure consciousness.
Okay. Now I love this because it says out of boredom. They create, we always talk about humans, we kind of talk about like transcending, like I'll become a being of pure thought. That's like existentialism. Like you leave the confines of this boring place in order to achieve a state of perfect thought. They did it in reverse. They had that.
They started with that.
They just,
it was boring to them.
That's day one. You're a transcendent being of pure thought. That gets old.
In game. Go.
Right. We started at the end. This is boring as shit. So they create matter, energy, space, and time. That seems like a good idea. They just invent these ideas as a committee. And then I guess they saw it and it was good. That's the universe in which we live, the mess universe. But then one day, this committee started calling people before it and banishing them to the messed universe without explanation. Feeling too much shame to fight back, the banished Thetans followed orders and left.
Shame.
They were ashamed because the committee decided to banish them. It says,
go to this lesser world that you were with us when we created our universe, and then the matter, space, and time universe, and that's kind of below us, and we're going to send you there. And they were just like, aw, but didn't find it at all.
They're bored. So they create this other place and then they banish people they don't like to it. That's kind of like sentencing somebody to watch TV all day. I mean, they're so ashamed that, oh, we don't get to stay here in the boring place that we couldn't stand. Too bad. And they go to the mess universe. All right. All right. We don't we're making fun, and that's because it fucking deserves to be made fun of.
It's just so crazy. So they're banished. But in their banishment, they become bored in the mess universe. So they start to create life on planets. I guess, you know, planets just existed in the matter, in the mess universe. They're just already planets. So in their boredom, they start to create life on these planets, and they make bodies. They make the bodies that they create go to war with other bodies created by other Thetans who must apparently been banned there as well. Frustrated by losing, some of the Thetans taught their bodies how to capture other Thetan without realizing that they were teaching these bodies how to capture themselves. Now, I'm trying to wrap my mind around that sentence for 5 hours. But in some cases, the meat bodies revolted, and in other cases, both Thetans became trapped. And this refers to one of his earlier science fiction works, History of Man, in 1952. So he's taking elements from his science fiction writings and just putting them right into his religion.
Anything that he wrote previously might as well just make it fact. I wonder... I mean, this guy was a true believer. We don't want to make it out to seem like L. Ron Hubbard was just out to screw people over. He was out to screw people over for sure. But I think there's enough information that we can demonstrate that he really, really believed this stuff, even though he knew that he had created it.
Right. I think that experience under the, you know, the nitrous oxide and the dental procedure where he believed himself to die or, you know, whatever, maybe there's some complications, but he has this hallucination because then he, you know, later on sits down at a typewriter and just spews it out, you know, it just comes to him. Excalibur just comes blowing out of him from whatever he saw during that state. So I think you're right. I think he probably did truly believe it, but why not capitalize on it? And get that fame that I wanted anyway, that money that I was so yearning for anyway.
It's just a shame that he did such a poor job in being able to describe it. I wonder if in his mind it made a lot more sense and he just felt like he didn't have the words to. I mean, it's almost like he just kind of gave up. Like he's writing it and he just says stuff like out of boredom, they decided to do X. You know, he doesn't.
Right.
It's somehow there were other beings. He doesn't even take a shot at explaining it. He doesn't even try. These beings are bored, and so they just start creating bodies so that they can go to war with each other.
Yeah.
They like the game of it. They think it's good sports to create life just to watch it. This sounds like Yahweh.
It does. Because there's chosen people and then there's the other people. And, you know, when you go back to the origin stories of Yahweh and Elohim, we're talking about several gods. And let us make man in our image. And then it must be for the game of, you know, what God do you follow? What God do I follow? Who's chosen people and whose land is whose? And it was good sport for the gods.
All right. There were various methods used to trap a thetan, but the common denominator was curiosity. I like this. They're easily bored and they're curious.
Yeah.
They're troublemakers, but they're a little human-like. They're curious about things. They have questions. I'm not sure how much curiosity you can have about something that you yourself created, but they're very curious. They want more. They're always bored. The thetan would be attracted to a pole that gave off a kind of energy, and he would get stuck to it. Or
there's again that I'm not going to bother to explain it. It's a kind of energy.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Just think of a pole.
It's not a stripper pole or a barber pole. It's just a pole, and there's a kind of energy. And thetans stick to it.
That it works. They stick to it. Or this is the alternative. You can get a box, which a thetan would get stuck inside while trying to find out what was in it. So you just create a box, and thetans can't bear to leave a box unopened, I guess. They got to know what's inside the box. So they would go and try to open it. And when they would try to open it, the traps made use of the energy beams that thetans give off. These beams have specific waves used to interact with objects in the physical universe. This is from the Philadelphia Doctorate Course, Lecture 32, Flows, Dispersals, and Ridges, and Lecture 33, Anatomy of the Genetic Entity. So while the thetan itself is not something that can be trapped, the energy he uses to interact with the universe can be used to trap it. This sentence, God damn it. I hate this sentence. So while the thetan itself is not something that can be trapped, the energy he uses to interact with the universe can be used to trap it.
It's a contradictory statement. If it cannot be trapped, then it can't be trapped.
You're inventing traps to capture things that can't be trapped, and yet you can use their energy to trap them. Having been defeated, the thetans assumed the identity of the bodies they had created, whether they were robot, doll, insect, or meat bodies. Doll bodies are the little gray men that everyone talks about. He just throws that in.
Yeah.
Just right after a sentence explaining the four kinds of bodies. By the way,
it seems like another way to... You've heard of that. You've heard of those outside of my writing, so you know that it must be true. You've heard of nuclear physics, right? Well, I studied that.
You know, little gray men.
You heard of Puerto Rico?
Everyone talks about.
I was the first guy to survey the whole place.
You heard of Puerto Rico? I invented Puerto Rico. Good God. Doll bodies are the little gray men that everyone talks about. You know. So you've explained that. That's been bothering people. So we'll go ahead and in one sentence, we'll explain what little gray men are.
Boom.
Eventually,
done.
The thetans just done. Eventually, the thetans discovered that the meat bodies had a one up on all the other types of bodies. This is the term he uses, a one up on all the other types of bodies, because they could experience physical pleasures. The physical pleasure is what eventually caused thetans to get stuck in meat bodies because they enjoyed it so much. That's from the Philadelphia Doctorate Course, Lecture 9, Anatomy of Processing, Energy, Phenomena, Sensation. So there are four types of bodies: robots, dolls, insects, and meat. And only one of them can experience pleasure. So presumably, robots, dolls, and insects don't have nerve endings.
Yeah. Dolls, little gray men, don't experience physical pleasure.
Those little, you know, that everybody talks about, the little gray men, they don't experience pleasure at all. They apparently still have tactile abilities. They've got appendages and limbs and stuff.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, you guys know, everybody talks about these people. They've got arms, but
right.
I guess they're not able to like grasp objects well because they don't have nerves.
Yeah, they don't have sexual organs, right? They're always depicted as smooth, and they're always abducting humans and doing sexual experiments on them. So maybe it's true.
Maybe they're just sexually repressed. They're just frustrated, and that's why they're always anal probing people when they, you know, kidnap
like
them
out of the woods. Meat bodies express themselves sexually.
Right.
Okay, so eventually in the Milky Way galaxy, these people, these thetans trapped in bodies, created a society. It's much closer to the center of the galaxy than we are. This is the society from which we originate. This solar system, ours, first came to the attention of that society when one of their invader forces discovered that there was a planet in our solar system with minerals they needed. They destroyed the planet, which would later become the asteroid belt, so that they could mine it. They also developed a trading outpost on Mars.
That's practically common knowledge.
Well, yeah.
They destroyed the planet, which would later become an asteroid belt, so they could mine it. They also developed a trading outpost on Mars. Are you noticing the stream of consciousness aspect of this?
He's also developed.
This is a long trend. This is not new for him. He's writing the most important things ever written. He's writing things that are of incredible value to the human species. He's answering all the questions of how things came about. And he's just inserting sentences wherever the fuck. They also developed a trading outpost on Mars,
period.
They also
developed a trading outpost on Mars. Yeah, just that's secondary. It's just, of course you know that part, but, you know, they're the ones that
stick it in here.
Toss it right at the end.
It's a new religion. It's going to be even more remarkable than the Bible. And he's using terms like meat bodies had a one up on all other types of bodies.
Right. Somehow.
Fine literature, it's not. Okay. Later, and this is a character that he doesn't bother like explaining in any kind of length, just later, as if he's referencing it, later, Xenu would call forth all the artists and criminals of his society for tax assessments, freeze them, and place them all in the spacecraft shaped like DC-8 airplanes to send them here. He would implant them with memories of various religions while wiping their knowledge of history completely clean. Oh, dear. Okay. So, Xenu called forth all of the artists and criminals.
Well, I mean, who would you lump together?
When you're trying...
Criminals and... Judges? I mean, no. That doesn't fit.
Doesn't work. When you're trying to make a more perfect society, you got to get rid of all of the criminals because you want your society to be free of crime. Also, get rid of the artists.
That makes sense. Yeah. Well, the criminal part, I can get behind. There's an idea of we should probably separate criminals from the rest of society.
Mm-hmm.
While you're at it, throw all those damn artists in there. It's a little bit perplexing.
It's a little perplexing. Indeed. Okay. All right. Okay, so he called them forth for tax assessments, but they weren't actually tax assessments. He froze them, stuck them on spacecraft shaped like DC-8 airplanes, and sent them here. He would implant them with memories of various religions while wiping their knowledge of history completely clean. This implant was created using the help of psychiatrists, who are his key to keeping the society under his control. However, he knew this may not be a permanent solution, as the memories may wear off over time. So he destroyed the atmosphere on Mars and killed everyone on the planet so he could put an implant station there for disembodied souls to return to. He also placed one on Venus, and there is one in Africa.
And there's one in Africa. Another tack on to all this important information. And then, by the way, there's one just around the corner.
You got to have one in Africa. Maybe you can't make the drive to Venus or Mars.
Yeah, I can't get to Venus this weekend, but luckily there's one in the Congo.
There's a drive-through right in Africa. You can just hit the original continent. You're good. Okay. All right. So apparently Xenu understood the power of Dianetics because that's the only way to get the memories to wear off. It doesn't happen naturally. You have to go to Scientology and use auditing with an e-meter.
Yeah.
You gotta get audited so that you can find these engrams.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, when we say engram, that means memory. That means memory typically, or at least often, from a previous life. Engrams are memories that's clogging up one of the three portions of the mind. Xenu must have been aware of this, and so he created, you know, depots in our solar system so that he could reinforce the implants using using these bases on Mars, Venus, and Africa. This is from the Role of Earth lecture, 1952. I love that we're sourcing it. I love that we're taking the time to source this so that everybody at home
right.
can do their own independent research on the topic. We wouldn't want to get any of this wrong. The
no.
whole thing falls apart if you get part of this wrong. What if we had accidentally said that the one on Earth is in Asia? People would be, you know, we'd lose all credibility. Okay. The DC-8s come to Earth, and Xenu drops all of the frozen people from the tax audits into volcanoes and detonates them with nukes.
Then he placed a screen around the solar system to prevent anyone from escaping and also to prevent transmissions outside the solar system from reaching us. Now, outside of the solar system, there's a system of buoys that will be activated should anyone exit the solar system without permission. Once activated, these buoys will alert Xenu, and he will return to destroy the planet again, forcing us to start over.
God damn it. All right.
And I wanted to go just back up to the when he did the fake tax assessments and then actually froze the people and took them to volcanoes to blow them up. He froze them by injecting them in the lungs with a mixture of alcohol and glycol. That paralyzed them, and then he froze them. I'm not sure the freezing method. Probably liquid nitrogen, I mean, but I'm just guessing.
Okay. He's trying to get rid of artists and criminals, as one does. He calls them in for a tax audit.
It's interesting that the criminals showed up.
It really is. Why would they did he pass a law saying they had to go? Why would they follow it?
Right. Why would they follow that? They're criminals.
Oh. One wonders if they were in line like, wait a minute, we're all criminals.
Wait a minute. This might be some kind of trick. I don't know if you've ever seen like old episodes of Cops where they used to like, they couldn't serve warrants because people would run. So they would just like set up in some warehouse that they rented and they would send out like flyers saying, you want a TV? And then the guys would come in and then they would arrest. Are you who's your driver's license? Yep, that's you. You're under arrest.
Right. They always fall for it. Right. And we're not talking about like, you know, a handful of people here.
No, all of the criminals.
All of the criminals. There was the Galactic Federation that Xenu is the head of consisted of 22 suns with 76 inhabited planets. So that's like three or four inhabited planets per sun. We're talking about entire planets of people here. The aliens were supposedly similar in appearance to ourselves as we are now. The average populations of these planets was 178 million or 250 million on average. Both figures are quoted in the same line on the handwritten OT3 document. Okay, so it's contradictory inside of the exact same sentence.
What?
But, you know, whatever. It's somewhere, let's just call it 200 million. We'll split the difference. 200 million on average per planet. There was an overpopulation problem for Xenu. And there seems to also be a slight contradiction about whether or not he was doing it purely to solve an overpopulation problem that Xenu had, or if he was trying to get rid of criminals.
Well, there was, yeah, and there was another thing saying that Earth was the prison planet where he was putting, you know, Xenu's placing people that he believed were going to try and take away his regime, take away his power, and work against him.
If the story is to be believed, this would have happened to about 4 trillion people. The story makes it clear that the actual corpses of people were transported to Earth. Supposing each DC-8, we haven't even remarked on this. He said DC-8s.
DC-8, it was identical to a DC-8 in every way, save the fans, meaning the turbine engines.
So you wouldn't have that in space.
No, of course not. DC-8s fly right through space. There's no friction once you get it going.
Once you get it going. Supposing each DC-8 could carry 200 frozen bodies in refrigerated units at a time, and the excess population per planet was 100 million, then 500,000 DC-8 space plane flights would have been required to ship these people to Earth. If the return trip were 6 weeks, as mentioned in the assist lecture, in relation to the 3 weeks from Coltis to Earth, and if this were all achieved in 6 months, then each planet would have required 125,000 DC-8 space planes.
That's
a lot of space planes. That's a big, big fleet. I bring this up because this is ridiculous, and it's really easy. It's really easy to laugh at. You kind of have to. It's necessary to stay sane. Maybe that's the trick. You're exposed, you got to laugh at it. Otherwise,
when you're exposed too early, you just
throw yourself right out of the window of the skyscraper. You'll go insane. You have to inject a little bit of humor if you're not an OT3 or above.
But that's a nice scapegoat, it seems to me. Just like with Christianity, well, I'm not of the world, so if you're looking for worldly proof of me, you're not going to find it. If you're reading this before you're an OT3, no wonder you're laughing at it, just dismissing it. That makes sense. You're not an OT3 yet. You haven't been audited. You haven't lived. You haven't remembered your past lives. Of course, this is crazy to you. It's a nice, pre-setup of this is totally true, but you're not going to get it because you're not in.
It takes, because people believe this stuff, it takes a certain level of personal investment and conditioning to get to the point where with a straight face you're thinking, yeah, DC-8s, that makes sense. They put them in volcanoes and nuked them. That makes sense to me. If you're going to believe that, it's helpful. If that person is already in for a couple $100,000 and has already spent years becoming somewhat reliant on the auditing process and is seeing this actually impact their real life so that you can get them to buy the rest of this.
Well, especially with the things that we talked about earlier and the parts of it that are kind of intriguing, even to myself, where you're a little bit more confident, you're more sure with your words, you communicate clearly with your loved ones, you just feel like a better person. You're going to start seeing, I'm sure, out of that kind of behavior, successes in your job, successes in your friendship, and you're going to, when did this start happening? Oh, when I started practicing Dianetics. It's a confirmation bias at work. And then, like you're saying, that investment of money and time already, you almost have no choice but to accept it. Or like the people we talked about, Marty Rathman and others, leave at some point because you just can't wrap your mind around it any longer.
We at Informed Secular Minds believe that people should believe in things that are true. We think there is a long trend that is demonstrable in humanity of grand lies and extraordinary claims leading to sectarian violence. This is an extraordinary claim that leads at least to sectarian thinking. And so we would be remiss if we didn't take the time, even as we laugh and joke and jab, to apply a level of counter-apologetics, because it's also ridiculous when other religions make crazy statements. This seems funnier and weirder and stupider, but I don't know that it actually is. It's just newer. It's just less obvious in the world. You're not hit with this all of the time. You didn't grow up going to Sunday school learning about Xenu. Instead, you went to Sunday school learning about talking snakes and magic fruit. there is not much of a difference.
Right. It kind of seems to me like it's just newer. It's younger. Right. It's like America's newer, younger. And I'm sure we seem kind of stupid and whatever to, you know, European countries have been around longer. Newer things take time to adjust to.
In the interest of presenting some counter apologetics, we just showed you the math on how many DC-8s you would have to build in a very short amount of time. You've got 76 planets, each requiring 125,000 airplanes on overpopulated planets, which would require, one assumes, landing strips or some kind of facility from which they can be launched. This doesn't add up. Even if you suspend all your disbelief and go, okay, but people believe it, people are taking it seriously, like you have to do with Christianity or Mormonism or Hinduism or Islam, this is another religion for all intents. It's just as valid as those belief systems when it comes to the accuracy of its claims. So we have to use critical thought as we would with any other religion. We owe it to the people that are tempted to believe in this. We owe it to the people who currently do believe in this. Do the math. Figure out if you can understand how this would happen. Now, there's also the complete lack of archaeological evidence. According to this story, Xenu brought all of these corpses here, frozen in tubes with their souls still intact, these thetans, dropped them into specifically named volcanoes 75 million years ago. These volcanoes didn't exist 75 million years ago.
Right.
Take basic geography. Volcanoes don't last that long. We're on the surface of a cooling planet. 75 million years ago, Pangaea was more or less intact. There were dinosaurs walking around for another 10 million years after that.
Yeah, there were no human societies warring with each other.
75 million years ago, the biggest mammal on the planet was the size of a shrew. There was nothing close to human beings around yet. You can't just introduce meat bodies 10 million years before the extinction of dinosaurs and act like nobody's going to do a double take on that claim.
There are other aspects of that same kind of behavior in his writings where he's just going to completely sidestep by leaps and bounds, not even try to stay close to the scientific measure of time or anything and say, well, you know, I'm going to disagree by a few million or a few hundred million and it'll be within the realm of believability. No, I'm going to go trillions over the amount of people, the amount of time, and I'm not even going to address it.
Hubbard asserts that original thing, that original I choose to be and therefore I exist, that is the origin of the universe and that it happened 4 quadrillion years ago.
4 quadrillion.
Everybody in the world should hear that and go, nope, that's fucking stupid. But it is not more stupid than thinking that the Earth is 6,000 years old.
Exactly.
It's just as dumb. But we read this and we go, how idiotic, and we go about our day. There are people that are willing to believe in this. Can you imagine if this was a majority religion? If this was something being taken seriously by any large group of people, if they were insisting that we teach the controversy in biology class, everybody would be up in arms. This is how I feel when the Texas Board of Education says that we need to spend just as much time teaching intelligent design to eighth graders as we do the theory of evolution. One is factual. One is complete and utter bullshit, but you've got enough people believing in a myth that they want it actually taught as academia in the public education system. Just pull out the 6,000-year-old claim and the talking snake.
And it's just as ridiculous.
It's just as dumb. He's saying that 71 million years before the emergence of anything resembling man, a bunch of men were dropped into volcanoes that could not have existed and were then nuked.
Hamilton on Periscope said that this is the sunken cost fallacy, the misconception that you make rational decisions based on the future value of objects, investments, and experiences. The truth is your decisions are tainted by the emotional investments you accumulate, and the more you invest in something, the harder it becomes to abandon it. Now, what we were talking about for how you have to, this is why you got to be an OT3 before they tell you this part of it.
They need you to be invested. Well said. Thank you, Robert, for putting that in there. Yeah. That's exactly it. Wow. Rational decisions based on the future value of objects, investments, and experiences. We're just about out of time, but I wonder if I have time for this, the last claim that we'll get to tonight. It says that there's a system of buoys that will be activated should anyone exit the solar system without permission. Once activated, Xenu will return and destroy the planet again, forcing us to start over.
And how long does it take Xenu to get here?
6 weeks?
6 weeks.
Six weeks, right. For him to get here. Okay. You guys know what the Voyager Project was, right? In the 70s? You had Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. This was the thing. Carl Sagan was kind of sort of involved. They made the golden record with recordings of humanity on it. Launched it out. It's really, really cool. It's a neat idea. It's kind of cute looking back, but the idea was we were gonna shoot these things way out. They were gonna study some planets on the way out of the solar system, but we don't have a way of bringing them back. We don't have a way of like steering them back towards us. So they're just still going. Voyager 1 may or may not have already passed out of our solar system. If it is not, it is very, very close, and we will get further confirmation in the next few years. It takes a year to transmit information from Voyager 1 to us. If Scientology is correct, the buoys have already detected or are about to detect the Voyager 1 spacecraft. If Scientology is correct, we must assume that Voyager 1 has not quite reached the boundary of our solar system yet, but is about to. And Xenu will be here promptly to kill us all.
Yeah, we got about a month and a half.
On that note, I'm going to leave everybody to their nightmares tonight. We're going to do another episode next Wednesday, and we're going to fill this in with a little bit more context. We're going to tell you a little bit more about L. Ron Hubbard. We're going to talk about some more of these extraordinary beliefs, and we're going to talk about some of the figures in Scientology, including the celebrities that everybody knows about. This has been the Informed Secular Minds podcast. This was episode 12, still rocking and rolling. We want to thank Scott L. Duderino, ELDUDEIRENO, for being the guest host again this week. Follow him on Twitter and on Periscope. Thank you to Young Athlon 399 for running the scope for us this week. Guys, we need you to go to patreon.com/informedpodcast and help us out so that we can keep making awesome content on the show. We thank you as always for listening, and we hope that you have a wonderful night.